गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। इन द लास्ट सेशन वी आर ट्राइंग टू फाइंड आउट द हाइबरनेट द डिफरेंस बिटवीन गेट एंड लोड मेथड। सो लाइक व्हाट एग्जैक्टली द गेट मेथड इज वर्किंग एंड सेम वे द लोड मेथड हाउ इट इज वर्किंग वी आइडेंटिफाइड इन द लास्ट सेशन। सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस वन इंपॉर्टेंट कॉन्सेप्ट कॉल ट्रांसैक्शन सेल। सो हाउ वी कैन वर्क ऑन द ट्रांसैक्शन इन हाइबरनेट, दिस सेक्शन ऑफ कोड वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस इन अवर टुडे सेशन हियर। So to discuss this particular session here, first we need to understand some of the diagram here, how these particular transactions are going to work internally. Basically, how the transaction object we are creating, with help of this particular session, we are trying to creating, like we are calling the one method. With help of this particular method, we are getting a transaction object. So what is the method we are calling? Begin transaction, session dot the begin transaction. This method will return the transaction information here. And how this particular transaction is going to work in our Hibernate applications here. So this we need to understand. So we'll see basically using this particular transaction management, we are going to work on the transactions here. We are going to work on the transaction. So now how this particular transaction is going to fail here. So how this particular transactions are going to work. Let's see. If we observe, so this is our application. Now this is our payment gateway. This is our payment gateway. Now what I am doing here? Here we are having item here. So inside this particular item, we are trying to book some item here. How we are going to book? So we filled with some information here, and I click on the, like I provided the item details as well as how I am going to make the payment. So those details also I provided. So for example, I provided my credit card details here. So once we provided the credit card details, now what happens internally? Again, the application is going to connect into the different application here. So what is the different application is going to connect? This is our payment gateway. So using this particular payment gateway, we'll try to connect our appropriate bank here. So for example, here the credit card we are going to work on the HDFC. Getting the point. So we are going to work on the HDFC. Now what happens here? This particular HDFC bank will connect it here. Getting the point. This particular HDFC bank will connect here. Now here we need to focus here inside this particular HDFC bank whether this particular credit card is eligible. If it is eligible, do we have a limit to make this particular payment? Or that expiry date and the transaction details are in the within the period. So we need to check all the details here. If something is failed here, the expiry date or the credit limit is expired. Getting the point. So based on some unwanted information like the credit card is expired here. Now what happens here? So whatever the transaction we are performing here, like whenever we click on internally, so new transaction is going to created here. And once this particular transaction is failed here. Once this particular transaction is failed, we want to roll back all the information here. Because, so in this account, like the person who is trying to make the payment, the credit card is expired here. The expired credit card, we cannot make the payment here. So all the information we need to check before making the payment here. Now what happens here? So this particular HDFC bank will return successful transaction here. But to the inside this particular successful transaction here, the payment is not made here. Payment is not made because of some credit card expired date here. Now what we need to do? So we cannot give the complete transaction information. So we cannot make the item here. We need to roll back the transaction and do that. Some information we need to store. Getting the some information we can store, like share the information to the user. Whatever the credit card you provided, the credit card is expired here, and the transaction we need to roll back here so that this particular item cannot booked by the person here who is trying to book this particular item. How we are going to make this particular information? How we are going to roll back the current transaction if anything we got any exception? Exception in the case the credit card is expired. So this is one exception we can consider here. Now observe how we can write. Basically, we identified the transaction we are going to get the object with help of the session. And the transaction related information we can define within the try catch block here. So So using the try catch block here, what we will do? Here we are going to write the begin transaction. Getting the point, begin transaction, and here we are going to get the TX. TX is nothing but transaction object here. So now TX dot commit. TX dot commit, and we'll close the catch block here, and we'll open, sorry, try block will close, and we'll open the catch block here. Inside this particular catch block, now what we are doing is we are trying to write some exception here. EX information, and here what we will do, we'll try to roll back the current transaction here. TX dot rollback. TX dot rollback the current transaction here. If everything is successful, this particular transaction dot commit will perform. And if any exception we got, now what we are doing is we are trying to roll back the current transaction here. Whenever we are rollbacking here, so no data is not going to inserted into the any database here. Whatever the database we are going to work, the data will not inserted here. Cutting the point. So this is all about the simple example on the transaction, the real time example. Where exactly this transaction is going to work, and Hibernate transaction internally is going to work based on the four components here. So these are the four component here, AC, ID. Cutting the point. Now we'll discuss more about this particular AC ID when we are discussing about the Spring transaction here. Okay, in the Spring also is going to perform the same components here, the four component based on this particular four components. The transaction is going to perform, okay? But observe in the Hibernate here, basically Hibernate is going to work on the our system level database transaction here. Getting the point? The database transaction is going to work, and the database transactions also is going to perform the based on this particular four component. So ACID, ACID is nothing but A means atomic, and C means consistency, I means isolation, and D means durable. So these are the four component we are going to have. We'll discuss more about this particular component here. Just we need to understand here how we can work on the transaction in our Hibernate applications here. Okay, now back to here. So now here what we are going to do with help of this particular transaction. Now we identified whenever we are trying to perform any the transaction, like the online application here, the transaction is going to work on the within the lifespan here. So it's going to have the short lifespan here. So within the short lifespan here, the transaction is going to perform. So if it is taking more time, so we cannot get the expected result here, and whatever the business we are going to achieve, the business is going to run in a loss here, because if it is taking more time here, so we cannot try and do the item is going to deliver to the user without making the payment sometimes. So without making the payment also, the item is going to deliver to the user account here. Getting the point? So this kind of operation we cannot make here. So because of this, whenever the online any applications we are going to work, the database transactions is going to have the short lifespan here. It's going to have the transaction is going to perform within the short life cycle time here, and it's going to take more time. We can define the transaction timing here, the transaction timing within the how much time we can close the particular transaction, so that if the transaction time is closed, automatically the transaction is going to roll back here. Getting the point? So this is all about the simple example. Now understand this particular transaction diagram, how it's going to work here. Here, this is our initial state here. The transaction is going to perform here, and after this, now what we are doing here, we are going to work on this is all about our transaction here. And if the transaction is successful commit here, we are going to call the commit section, and if it is failing here, we'll go for the rollback section here. We'll go for the rollback section. Now understand here. So in the initial transaction, how it's going to perform here? Okay. If you observe here, now what we are doing here, we are trying to begin the transaction. Getting the point. And it is a initial state. And so what exactly it is? It is a transaction. And here we are going to try to commit here. And here it is a rollback here. Getting the point. Now what happens exactly here? Commit and rollback here. Commit and rollback. So now if you see, whenever this particular transaction started, whenever this particular transaction started here, for example, here we are trying to click on the button here. So we are making submit button. Getting the point. We are making this particular submit button here. So whenever we are making the submit button, what it will do internally, the transaction is going to started here. And here, whenever the transaction started, here we are going to work on the third party APIs here. The payment gateways here to perform the payment related information here. So inside this particular, the third party APIs here, if based on this particular response here, the transaction is going to committed, or if any exception, the transaction is going to roll back here. Getting the point. So commit is nothing but the transaction. Once the transaction is successful, once the transaction is successful here. Succeeded and failure, transaction failure. Getting the point. So this is the diagram is going to provide the more information regarding our transaction here. The transaction is going to started here. Getting the point. Transaction started. Now internally it is connected to our third party API. This particular API is returning successful messages. The transaction is going to commit. Based on any exception, the current transaction is going to fail here. Okay, so back to here. Now what we need to understand here, basically, so whenever we are trying to work on the JDBC and JTA transaction, Hibernate also internally is going to work on the JTA transaction. So when it is working on the JTA transaction, now what we can do here, the set auto commit we can make as a false here. By default the auto commit will become true. Now what we can do, we can make the false, because even though the transaction fail, what we will do, we'll try to perform the rollback like a failed transaction information here. Getting the point. Now if you observe, we don't want to make the failed information here. So for this case, now what we can do, we can make the auto commit as a false, set auto commit as a false. We'll see how this particular, where exactly the method will available here. Getting the point. Now so as discussed here, Hibernate is going to work on the JPA related transaction. We'll observe how we can define the JPA related transaction. Let's see, for example here, the main class only I want to define. Here, now what I'm doing here? Here I am trying to define the session above, and after the session above, I'm opening try block here. Inside this particular try block here, now what I'm doing here? I'm trying to work on the transaction here. So here the transaction I'm making null. Catch block. Inside this particular catch block, now what we can do? If anything failure here, now first we need to check here if transaction not equals to null. Inside this particular catch block, roll back here, getting the point. So now what we are doing here, we are trying to work on the rollback here, and here we are going to call the submit method. Here we'll call the submit method. Now what we are doing inside this particular submit method, we'll try to connect the APIs here, getting the point. Here we will try to connect our APIs here. Based on this particular submit method, if it is returning some exception, the transaction is going to roll back here. Otherwise, here we can write the transaction commit here. Transaction commit. Getting the point. So this is the way we can work on the transaction information inside any Hibernate related application. When we are trying to perform the database operation, if we want to make any transaction. So this is the try catch block we can write, and we can create the new transaction. We can create the new transaction. We can call the appropriate method, so to perform some operation here. And if everything goes successful, we can commit. Otherwise, we'll roll back the particular transactions here. Getting the point. And finally, now what we can do? So inside this particular finally block, we can close the session related information. So where we define this particular session related information, if we observe here session dot close, cutting the first session dot close here. So this is all about the transaction example we are going to work with the Hibernate information, and the transaction and rollbacks are going to work, getting the point. So this is very important here, and we'll go for another important concept called flushing here. So this is also important concept we need to understand in Hibernate here, how this particular session flushing is going to work, and what exactly we need to understand the regarding our flushing here. Basically, flush is nothing but, so whenever the transaction is going to commit the data, the data is going to store into the database here. So before, the data will not store into the databases here, getting the point. Before, if we want to store the data into the database here, we can go for this particular flush concept here, getting the point. So we can go for the flush concept here, session dot flush here. If you see, here we are going to have the method call this method. Now this particular method, what it will do internally is going to store the data into the database, but it is not going to commit the data. It's not going to commit the data here, getting the point. Now if you observe, so here we are trying to working on the category object here. Okay. So we save the object with the help of this particular session dot save here. Session dot save. The same object. Now what I'm doing in some other example, we'll try to load the same object here. Getting the point. If this particular concept is not available, whenever we are trying to load the category related object here, again we are going to get an exception here, because the category object data is not stored into the database here. The category data object is not going to store into the database here. Now what we can do here, to load the data, first we need to save the data. To save the data, we need to call this particular method here, session dot flush method. So this particular method is going to store the data into the database. Now it is not going to committed, but based on some exception here, if the transaction is going to roll back here, whatever the data we store into database, all the data is going to roll back here. Correct the point. So it is nothing but the data is going to store in the cache. So once the transaction is going to committed the particular object here, the data is going to saved into the database here. The data is going to save into the database here. So this is very important. We need to understand here. Getting the point. Now, how we are going to understand this particular flush? So inside this particular, we are having one enum here. The enum flush mode. I think. Let me open here. So this is all about our flush mode. Now you can see what we are doing here. We are creating never, manual, and commit here. Auto, always. Getting the point. So now you can see these are the types of the flush modes we are having here. How we want to save the data into the database whenever we are trying to call the session dot flush here. Session dot flush. Now you can see what exactly it is giving the information. So here is never flushed unless the session dot flush explicitly call the application here. So by default we can make these are the operations here. But if you observe here, this particular session is not going to flush it until the explicitly we'll call the session dot flush method. Getting the point. Whenever we are calling this particular never, what happens internally? It's not going to flush the data into the database until we'll call the explicitly session dot flush here. And now you can see another one manual here. Now what is doing it? So it's going to this particular session is going to flush here when explicitly call the application here. When explicitly we are going to call the session dot flush here. Same way commit here. If the transaction is going to commit, the data is going to flush here. So now auto here. So this is the default one. It's not going to perform any behavior here. Cutting the point. But now you can see sometime it's going to flush here before the query execution here. Sometimes it's going to flush here. But now you can see this is the default behavior. You can understand how the flush mode is going to work. And auto here. And always here. So now you can see what we can do. This particular session is flushed before the every query. Before the every query. But it is not always. So it's going to give inconsistent results here. And we can call it as insufficient here. So we cannot go for the always every time here. So based on our requirement, we can go for these are the particular types here. Hearing that, these are the particular types we can understand here how it's going to work internally. Now you can see each one having some number here. So this particular number is going to work on the flush mode concepts here. Getting the point. So flush mode dot will go for the manual, flush mode dot commit, because we are working on the static variabilities. Based on the class name, we can define this particular variable here. Getting the point. This is all about the particular flush mode concepts here. Basically, before saving the data, like before committing the data, if you want to save, these are the operation, like option we are having to perform the data into the databases here, right? And now what we can do, lock mode concepts here. So how we can work on the locking concepts here? In the previous example, we identified the simple example on the locking concept here. So what is the locking concept we discussed in the previous example? Where we define the locking concepts here? Okay. So in the maybe the example is missed out here. But whenever we are trying to load the data, we define some lock concepts here. So let's see how we can work on this particular log concepts here. How we can work on the particular log concepts here. If we observe session dot get, I am trying to call, and I will try to specify the category class ID, and here I want to provide the something called new lang 4, and after providing here we are having one more option here, log mode here. One more option we are having, log mode here. Now how we can define this particular log mode here? Now if you see, log mode, these are the particular variables we are having inside this particular log mode here. So we'll try to focus on these are the variables, how it is implemented here. So to understand here, first what we can do, we'll try to open this particular log mode here. Now you can see how this particular log mode is going to work. So where this particular log modes are implemented. So this is all about the none, read, upgrade, and upgrade is deprecated some ways on the some version, and upgrade now at write, force, carrying the pen. So these are the different types we are having it. So these are the different types we are having here. Now what you are understanding here, if you see the each one, we can understand here none here. First we'll focus on the lock mode concept none here. So what is doing here? No lock required. No lock required here. If an object is requested with this lock mode, carrying the pen. Now you can see first they're providing lock mode. This particular lock is not required. But if any object is requested with the lock mode, lock will obtain is necessary. Carrying the pen. If it is necessary here, the lock move, what it will do, so where this particular lock is going to this particular lock is going to lock it here on the particular object here. So which object we are trying to load? Category object here, carrying the point, category object. So based on the category object, once the category object is loaded, now so we are going to make the locking on the the category object here. So once we make the lock here, we cannot perform other operations here. We cannot perform other operations here. Getting the point. So by default, so this is the default one. Getting the point. This is the default lock mode we are having here, and we are not going to make any locks here, right? And we'll see read here. So the second lock mode we are having read here. Now you can read this particular message so that we can understand the how exactly the read lock mode is going to perform, and here is providing some shared lock here. Is going to provide the some shared lock here. Objects in the lock mode were read from the database in the current transaction rather than being the full from the cache. Getting the point. Now what you understand here? So basically, it's going to make the some shared lock system here. And the objects they are trying to load based on the current transaction here, we can perform the read lock mode here. So instead of loading from the cache here, rather than loading from the this particular cache here, but the read lock mode is going to work based on the current transaction. So current transaction is nothing but if we create a newly transaction or with help of any existing transactions also, this particular lock mode is going to perform, but only database records here is not going to perform the cache related records here. Getting the point. It's going to provide the some share locking system here whenever we are trying to load data from the database here. And now you can understand the another one here, upgrade here. So now you can see upgrade here. This is an upgrade lock here. What it is doing here? objects loaded into this lock. Getting the point, objects are going to load into this particular lock mode or using this particular SQL query, sir. So select query or update query. Getting the point, whenever we are trying to load the select or whenever we are trying to update the particular object is going to make the locking here. Getting the point, it's going to make the lock concept here. So once we are making the lock here, we can other table like other transaction cannot perform. The another transaction cannot perform the update or load or insert or any delete here because the current table is locked here. The category table is locked here, right? So this is the one more way we can make the lock the particular locking system here, and another one we are having here. Upgrade now, wait here. Getting the point. So here, what exactly it is providing the information here, and it is also it's going to make the lock concepts here. And here, what we need to understand here. So it's internally is going to work on the upgrade here, but only the difference here. Select for update, no wait here. No wait here. So without waiting, whenever we are trying to selecting and we are updating the records here, so this particular lock concept is going to work here. And another one we are having write operation. Whenever we are trying to inserting here, it's going to make the locking system here. And another one we are having here. So basically, this is also similar to the upgrade here, except that the version entities, getting the point, the version entities is results in a force version increment here. Based on this particular object version, this particular lock is going to work. Most of the time, we are going to use write, and we are going to work on the upgrade here. So other than these two, we are not going to work in our real-time applications here. But now, what you are understanding here? So this particular lock concept is going to perform whenever we are trying to perform in a multi-threaded application. Getting the point? Multi-threaded application to make the payment or to communicate with the same item by the different users here. If you observe, here we are having one item here. So for example, e-commerce website here. Inside this particular e-commerce website, we are having one item we are trying to book by the multiple users here. Now what happens internally? This item can be booked by only one user, and the remaining user, we need to show the some message here. We need to provide the message here. But how we are going to provide the message here? Getting the point. Now if you see, all the users are having the same time. All the users, they are trying to book for the item here. So all the users click on the submit button here. They click on the submit button. So once they click on the submit button, now what happens internally? Again, they will try to make the payment here. So whenever they're trying to make the payment here, now what happens internally? If all the transactions coming in the same time here, so we are having only one item, but amount paid by the multiple users. But we don't have a multiple items here. But here, who is going to lose here? The user is going to lose here because the amount is deducted from his account, but is not going to receive the item here. Getting the point? If I'm performing like this, from the next time onwards, no one user will come into our application. They cannot buy the any item here. So here we are having some business losing here. Okay. So in this case, even though multiple users they are performing on the same data at same time, now what we can understand here? So using this particular lock mode concept, we can make the lock here. So once we make the lock here, only one user can perform the operation. So once a user completed, the lock is going to release automatically so that the another user can perform the operation. Getting the point. So once one user is entered into the making the payment here, other user, they will try to wait here. They will try to wait to make the payment here. So based on this particular one user experience, like based on some credit card eligibility or criteria or expiry date, now what happens here? So the user, the current user cannot make the payment here. Now what happens internally? So we are giving an option to enter the one more user. We're giving the option to enter the one more user. Same way, these are the users are will wait and will complete the so their transactions here. And between any one user is performed here, so the remaining user, they are going to get some message, some item is sold out here. Getting the point? So these are the concepts we can understand with help of this particular lock mode here. Now we can see, so the lock mode we can make like this here. Lock mode dot. Upgrade here because we are trying to load the data here. And after loading, we'll try to update here. So this is all about the particular lock mode concepts here. And so based on this particular lock mode concept here, we are trying to understand the how we can perform the multi-threaded environments applications here. So not only the e-commerce application, now you can think any applications here. Whenever we are trying to perform the multi-threaded environment here. Okay. More than one thread, if I'm trying to working with the application, so the locking system is going to work here. If it is a single threaded application here, one by one threads will enter here. So we don't have a scope to enter multiple threads at a time here. Right? So now we'll see the simple example, like the example we already discussed in the previous example. Getting the point? We already discussed the simple example here, how exactly the transactions are going to work. So in this case, now what I'm going to write here, the category information. Getting the point? Category information I'm going to load here. For simple understanding here, inside this particular submit method, now I will define. Okay, so session we are getting here. Let me pause the submit method. Okay, simple understanding I'm trying to define here. So whenever we are trying to start this application here, now what I'm doing here internally, we are trying to call the lock mode upgrade here. We're having so duplicated here. Okay. So if we want to understand here, now what we can do, we'll try to print the message here. We will print the message here. So what is the message I'm going to print here? Line number here. So why I want to print this particular line number here? Basically, sorry, we need to go for the load method here, not get method. So load method, this particular load method is going to throw an exception here. Okay. So now you can see line number 41. Now what you understand here? Line number 41 is nothing but while loading this particular session object here, we are getting an exception. So once we get an exception here, now where we move here? So we back to the catch block. Now you can see we defined inside the catch block here. Catch block is open line number 38 and it's closed 43. So in between we define the line number 41 here. And the same line number is printing on our console here. Now what you are understanding is whenever we get any exception here, the transaction is rolled back here. The transaction is rolled back here, and we are printing the line number message. Same way in the real time also, we'll define the methods like this. We'll call the transaction, and we'll create a method, and we'll perform the operation, and we'll commit the changes here. Right, and any exception we got, the transaction is going to roll back like this here. Getting the point? So in this case, in the current example, we got an exception here. In the current example also, we got an exception, something called no row given with identifier ID. So this is also one exception here. So once we get this particular exception here, catch block is handling the exception, and it is printing this particular message here. Getting the point? Now we'll try to understand the caching, how exactly the caching is going to work. Basically, in the Hibernate applications here, we are having two level of caching here. First level cache, and the second one, second level cache here. Now we'll understand how the first level cache and the second level cache is going to work. Getting the point? So to understand this particular first level cache and the second level cache, first we need to understand some scopes here. We are having different scopes here. The scopes here, transaction scope, process scope, and cluster scope here. We'll see how these particular scopes are going to work here. Getting the point? To understand this particular scope, first we need to understand the first level cache here. Getting the point? First level cache. First level cache is going to work with session. First level cache is going to work with the session. We don't want to define explicitly here. Everything is going to handle by the session here. Only we need to focus on the session level, second level cache. And now this particular first level cache is mandatory, and it cannot be turned off here. Getting the point? So we cannot go for the, we cannot disable the first level cache here. It is a mandatory cache because Hibernate is going to work based on the some caching. So in the last example we discussed here, while loading the, like while calling the get method or the load method, now what is doing internally, it's calling, first it's going to check for the object is available in the cache. If it is not available, it will go for the second level cache. Okay, now we'll understand here how this particular the first level cache is going to work internally here. Okay, now we'll see whenever we are trying to call the, like whenever we are trying to insert the data, what it will do, it will save the data into the cache first, and later it will save the data into the database here. But here the IDs we are going to have same here. Getting the point? So based on the ID, what it will do, whenever we are trying to load the object here, first it will go into check for the cache, and if the object is found in the cache, it will not going to communicate with the database. From the cache level, the object is going to store return here. And if the ID is not available, it will go for the database, and it will hit the database and it will load the object here. So this is the way the session level cache we are going to call, it's going to work like this. And now we need to understand the second level cache here. Getting the point? Second level cache. The second level cache, how it's going to work, we'll have different cache providers here. Based on the different cache providers here, we are going to enable the second level cache here. The second level cache is our optional cache here. Getting the point? So we can go for the on the each class or for the some association. Getting the point? Work 1-to-1 or 1-to-many or 1-to-1. So based on the some association, or if we want to declare the for each class, we can define the this particular second level cache here. Right? And the second level cache is going to work on the application requests here on the same or the persistent object. Whenever it's going to call the within the same session here. Getting the point. This particular second level cache, the particular persistent object is going to call more than once. The second level cache come into the picture, and it will try to save the object based on our requirement, like how we are going to enable based on the persistence class, or based on the, now we can call it as a association here. The four association we are having, based on the association, the objects are going to store into the cache here. Right. Now, if we want to understand the second level cache, now what we can do? Simple here, we can define the, whenever we are trying to work on the, whenever we are trying to work on the mapping here, like association, we can go for the cache usage. So, for example, in the last session, we identified bid and item here. And here, now what we can do? In the class level, where in the, okay, inside this particular class here, what we can do, we'll have a one tag called cache here. One tag called cache here. So using this particular cache, now we can specify the how we can write here. So now you can see the cache by default we are having read only is nothing but while loading the data, this particular caches are going to enable here. While loading the data only, the caches are enabled here. Now what we can do, we can write here read only or read and write operation, read and write operations here. So now what you understand again, whenever we are performing loading and inserting or updating, the cache is going to insert the data into the second level cache here. Getting the point. So this is a way we can go for the cache configurations here on top of the class, or we can go for the on top of the any association here. Association, whenever we are trying to work here inside this particular set. Getting the point. So association nothing but we'll go for the set here. Here we can define the cache here. And we can define read only or read and write operations here. Read only or the particular read and write operations we can define here. Let's see what is the error we are getting. Class must be, what is the error we are getting here? Multiple annotation found. That the content of elementor class must match with okay, where it is close. Why it is giving an error? Class must match with the meta, sub element, cache, synchronous comment, ID. So this is all about the, okay, so whenever we are working on the cache, it's giving an error. ID, composite ID, discriminator, natural ID. Here we are having cache here, but we define the same thing here. Load, delete, fetch profile. Okay. Cache is matching here, but still it is giving an error here. Okay. We need to understand here. inside this particular mapping document here, how they're defined here. Okay, we are having here cache. So this is the message only we are getting here. Catalog entity proxy lazy. Okay. Tuple class. Element join. Element ID, composite ID, discriminator, version, subclass, join subclass. Okay, let me copy cache, like how the cache is implemented. Okay, read only, read and write to required. Okay, read only. Cache uses we define, cache reason here, and cache include. Okay. Reason. What is the reason we can define? Basically, reason also we are going to create manually. Basically, it is matching here. Why it is giving an error here? We'll take help from the Google, like anything we are missing. But I'm saying I'm not missing anything here. No. Form not XML. This is also okay. So there is no answer. Right. So the mapping level, it is not implemented. Node here, schema, where here. So we cannot define the prop attribute here. Just we can go for the same here, cache here. Okay. Maybe after the this particular meta we can define. Right. If you observe here, the order is giving an error here. If you go to this mapping, this is the first element, Hibernate mapping, second one meta, and where they define the cache. So first we need to provide the meta, sub select, and the third one cache. But now what I will do, I provided cache as a first element, now it is giving an error here. It's giving an error. The second, the cache we provided here. So without getting an error, we are able to so run this particular example happily here. Right? Now what you're understanding is, so this is the operation what we want to write. So we can go for it. And now we already identified the cache related example. Cache So these are the types we are going to provide here. Read only, read and write, and so no heuristic read and write, and transactional. So these are the different types we are having here. So how we want to differentiate, we can go for this particular the usage here, and the second one we can go for the reason here. So reason, based on the cache provider, we are going to work on the reason here, in the which region we want to cache here. And third one, we are going to work on the include here. So cascade here, getting the point. The cascade we are going to provide here, like whenever we are perform the save or update or delete or all the operation, we can define the cascade information here, right? This is a simple the configuration for this particular second level cache. And once we are providing here, we can write the, like we can run the example. Based on the first 40 it will do, it will go to the cache. It will insert the data into the cache, and later it will insert the data into the database. Getting the point. This is all about the cache related example here. Any questions regarding this particular caches and the transactions and lock mode and flush information? So these are the concepts we discussed so far. Anyone having any questions here? Okay, if we don't have anything here, now what we will do, we'll move on to the another concepts called here. So understanding the Hibernate type system here. Basically, if we observe whenever we are trying to providing the particular ID long, how this particular column is going to, how the column, the data type is going to identified here. Getting the point. Based on this particular long and we are going to providing the type here. And in the previous example, so whenever we are discussing about the new date concepts here, we define the date property, date to data type we defined here. Okay. So in that case, the particular date data type here, how we can work on the particular type is going to converting into the database column here. So these are the information we need to understand here. Basically, we are having the built-in mapping types here. So for example, most of the Java related data type, whatever the data types we are having here, for each and every data type here, internally we are going to have the specified the column data type here. For example, whenever we are trying to work on the long, so in the ORM tool, we are going to have a long here. So let's see if I'm going to provide the description of hp.c_bid. Okay. So to understand this, directly we can click on this particular table. Now what you are understanding your data type here? Int 8 here. But what is the data type we given in our bid class here? Long here. We provided long here. Getting the point. But how it is converted here? Based on the dilate here. Getting the point. Based on the dilate, the particular data type is going to converted here. For now, so what are the basically in our ORM tool here, based on the data type, like what are the data type we are having in Java. So based on the same data type here, we are going to have a same database column data type here. But here, the data type is going to change based on the database here. Based on the database. How the database is going to change based on the dilate here. So see how we are having the relation here. Getting the point. So ORM tool is having same data type, whatever the data type we are having in Java. But whenever we are trying to work with each database here, Dialet is going to convert the Java data types into the database data types here. Database data type. So in that case, this particular BID we are having long, but in our Postgres database, it's converted into the integer. Now these are the data types we are having. These are the data types is going to support in our Postgres database. Postgres database. Now you can see amount to the string we are having. It is var carrier. It is var carrier. Again, the item ID we specified as a integer. Internally, it is converted into the integer, but we provided as a long here. For all the long data types here, the database column data type here, integer it here. So default one, the data like Dialet is converted this data type here. Okay, so this is the way we can easily understand here how we can convert the how it is converting into the database data type here. And along with this, like whenever we are having custom data types here, whenever we are having custom data types here, how we can write here. So whenever we are having the custom data types here, so as we discussed in our earlier example, whenever we are discussing the Hibernate architecture, we discussed one interface called types here. Getting the point, types. Based on this particular types here, we can define the particular custom data types here. Based on this particular custom data type, we can go for the types here. Now, if you observe, we are having something called types here. Where is the Hibernate types? Yes, in the RSQL. Now you can see integer, big into, and float here. Now you can see, so double numeric, getting the point. So these are the values we can store whenever we are trying to work with a custom data type here. Whenever we are going to work on the custom data type. So these are the variable we are having, and internally this is the value is going to store here. Internally, this is the value it's going to store here. Getting the point. When we are this particular types is going to work for the custom data types. For the predefined data types here, the Dialet is going to convert it into the appropriate database column data type here. Okay. So this information I want to provide here, and now we need to focus more about the association we'll understand here. In the previous example, we discussed about the one to many association. Now we can go for the one to one association here. So as of now, so far we discussed all how this particular Hibernate is going to work internally. The internal information we are discussing here, the transaction related information, as well as the flush mode information, lock mode information, getting the point, and some of the built-in data types here. But now we need to understand the one-to-one association. How exactly the one-to-one association is going to work? Basically, so if you want to dedicate this particular table like address and user, getting the point, address and user. In the previous example, how we identified? In the user table, we define the component here. In the user table, we define the component here. So whenever we are defining this particular component here, now what happening is inside this particular user table, we insert the data. See the caching concepts here, basically. Where is item? Where is item? basically now what I'm doing here, I'm trying to providing this particular cashier tag here for the class level, for the which class I'm providing a item class here. And whenever this particular item class is inserted or updated or is going to deleted here, now what we will do, the data is going to store into the cache here. The data is going to store by default into the cache. So, and here we are providing read and write operations here. So this particular read and write operations is going to perform. And now other than this, we are having read only. Only for loading, if you want to cache the data, we can go for the read only. And we can go for the each transactional, we can go for the this. And there is no restrictions here for the read and write here. We can go for this particular non-destructive read and write here. But to most of the time, we will use these two sections here, read only or read and write here. Getting the point. Now here, so when we are trying to work on the this particular include here. So this particular include, what it will do? And here we are working on the some relation here. What is the relation we are having? One to many. When we are trying to working on the one to many here, so what we will do, one object is saved, we are going to save the other objects as well. One object is deleted, we are going to delete the other object here. Same functionality, we want to get it into the cache level, we can go for the this particular include here. Include is nothing but we'll try to provide the cascade here. The cascade, we how we are working here, all how we are working on the all here, same way this particular cascade we are providing at the cache level, so that when we are trying to working on the association level, the dependent table information also is going to updated and is going to deleted here, right? Reason is nothing but based on the specific region. Based on the specific region, if we want to cache, we can go for this particular region. So otherwise, if we want to cache all the objects, so without providing this particular region, we can cache the all the object information here, right? So this is all about the cache here. But now whenever we are providing the cache, how the objects are going to cache? So we discuss the two level of caching. First level cache is associated with the session, and so by default it is required here. We cannot disable the first level cache, but the second level cache is optional. If we require the second level cache, we can go for it. Otherwise, the data, whatever the cache mapping we provided here, the data is going to store into the first level cache here. Okay, so whenever we are providing this particular cache, so it will store into the first level cache, because the first level cache is a mandatory one. So any questions? Okay. So back to here, how we can work on the one-to-one association here. Basically, in the previous example, how we implemented, in the user table, we'll try to provide the home address and billing address with help of the component attributes here. So now what we will do? With help of this particular one-to-one association, how we are going to provide the how we are going to make the relation between the which table and like user table and address table here. Getting the point. So to work on this particular one-to-one association, how we are going to write, first we'll create the address table, later we'll create the user table here, and user and address here, how we are going to communicating. So we are having two ways communication. The foreign key association, is nothing but again we are going to work on the many to one association here. Foreign key association is nothing but again we are going to work on the many to one. So many to one we discuss here when we are trying to work on the item ID. This particular item ID is working as a primary key for this particular item table. Same way when we are trying to work on the bid related mapping, for this particular bid related mapping here, again we are providing column item ID. This particular item ID here, inside this particular bit table is working as a foreign key here. Okay, and now observe, first we'll create the address mapping. To create this particular address mapping, now what I will do, XML file, address dot hbm dot xml, and here I want to change address table, and we can go for the address ID. We'll use the native sequence. Okay, now we need to understand the address class. So inside this particular address class, what are the properties we are having? So those properties we are going to define as a property here. So street, we can go for the street only, type string, and we are having three properties. So another one, we are having city, and zip code here. This is all about the zip code here. Getting the point. Now you can see, so many to one, like we'll remove this particular join here. So as of now, what I will do, I will comment out this particular join. So this is the simple address table, the address table mapping information. Now how we identify with the help of this particular foreign key, how we are going to write here, how we are going to write here inside this particular many to one here, we'll create the item here. Getting the point. Inside this particular address table, we'll go for the billing address here. Billing address will contain many for single user. But how we can define here? Here we can go for the billing address. This particular billing address, we can create the set of billing address in our, where we can create address class, in our address class here, and the column which column we can define here, billing column ID, sorry, billing address ID, and the class we can go for the address table, and we can go for the cascade here. But whenever we are making here, now what we are understanding here, so if you observe here, if you observe billing address ID, this particular billing address ID is going to associate with our user here. It's going to associate with the user. But here, billing address ID is different and user ID is different. User ID is different. So if you see, I want to close this. And here, now focus here, item ID, oh sorry, data is deleted. Okay, so we changed in the yesterday class the particular HBM to DDL, we created as a created and drop, so the data is dropped here. Okay, anyway, but here what I want to provide, item ID and bid ID is not equal. Item ID is different, bid ID is different. But here, how we are making the relation? So primary key with the foreign key relation here. Primary key with the foreign key relation, we are going to make the relation to the two objects here. Same way, if I want to enable this particular many to one here, now what we can do? First, we need to create a set of billing address, and the billing address information is going to store in our billing address ID. And the column, sorry, the class here, we can go for the address here. The class, we can go for the address, and here we can make the not null constant here. Okay, now we identified here. But in other case here, in other case, now what we will do? We'll go for the one-to-many association, and we'll go for the class user class, and we are going to make the association with the user ID here. Getting the point? And we are going to make the association with the user ID here. Getting the point? Now, in the user table, what we are going to write here? The data is going to store like this. The data is going to store like this. This is all about the our user table. Okay. And here what I will do, user ID. And billing address ID, some information like what are the properties we are having here. Username, password. So remaining columns, like what are the remaining column we are having. Back to here, address table. This is all about the our address table. And address ID. State here, city, and zip code here. But now what we need to understand here, the relation between these two tables, here we are going to have the relation. But here we don't have a relation. User ID is not going to connect it with the address ID. But here we are going to connect with our billing address ID. Billing address ID is going to connect it with our address ID. So because of this particular many to one matching here, because in the many to one, what is the column we are creating here? Billing address ID. The billing address ID is going to create at a user level and is going to associate with our address table. Getting the point? And here we are making here primary key and foreign key references here. But here I don't want to use this particular primary key and foreign key reference. I want to use primary key references only. But how we can go for the primary key association? So to define this particular primary key association here, we can define the one-to-one mapping, and here address here. Class is equals to address and cascade. We can go for the all. So we can perform all operations here. And same way, okay. And another one will create here. User class, and we'll go for the constraint ID here. The constraint ID, now what we can do, we can make as a true here. Cascade. Getting the point? And I want to copy this, the address information, and we need to paste into the inside this particular user table. getting in the user only we are having address component here. And let me go to the user class here. Now what we will do, we'll remove this particular address here and home address also. I don't want to make home address. So instead of removing, we can make comment here so that we can understand here how this particular billing address be implemented. Billing address. I want to comment out, and for this home address, this also I want to comment out, and we'll create a one more address. We'll create address here, and now what we will do, I want to generate address properties here, setters and getters here. After set properties, I want to generate address information. Now you can see in the user table, in the user mapping table, we provided address information, and same way in our address table we are having user information. So this is the way we can provide the user and address. Now we will open the address table, sorry, address class. Inside this particular address class we are having user, right? Now this particular hierarchy, so instead of connecting with the billing address ID, now we are going to connect it with our user ID. User ID is directly connected to the address ID. So there is no concept called billing address ID. There is no concept called billing address ID. Getting the point? So this is the way we can make the primary key association, and the previous example we discussed the foreign key association, right? Now to insert the data into the user and address, now what we can do, we'll go for the section code comment out, and transaction, and I want to create here user, new user, user dot username, one to one. Set password 121. Okay, and later, now what I will do, address address dot, so set to street here, you can go for this street here, and set city zip code, zip code here, and finally so set user, and we are setting the user information, and sorry, set address, right? And session dot save. Finally, transaction dot commit. And session dot close. Right, so this is the way we can make the object, and we can save, we can run the application here. Okay, second level cache is not enabled for the this particular Hibernate cache. Okay, now so what we can do to enable this particular cache, okay, so first we'll enable the second level cache here. To enable this particular cache, first what we can do, we need to work on the cache regions here. Now the cache regions, what I provided here, go to the Hibernate properties. Inside this particular Hibernate property, we need to provide the Hibernate dot cache provider underscore class. So what is the cache provider class we are having here? So instead of providing explicit class here, now what we will do, we'll go for the provider class here. And we will have a Hibernate provider cache here. Where is the Hibernate provider? Hibernate. net.sf. Okay, so we'll see, this is the default cache we'll provide here. Net dot sf dot, oh, I did not add a h cache. Okay, we'll add Hibernate dot provider and okay, so we'll change the EH cache provider. We'll go for the 3 version. So once this particular building is completed, we'll identify the cache provider information. So which one we can implement here? Here, any Hibernate related cache provider we are having? Transaction internal Alexa store.
और जी एस के जी एस पी एस टू हायर कैश रिटायर। Okay, so otherwise we'll understand the one more we are having here. We'll see with the different version. And here, basically, we'll get the what exactly the provider class we are having. Okay, Java util Java net.sf related. We are not getting any jars here. Okay, maybe we'll try with another one because I found out the net.sf eh cache we provided here. So the cache implementation here, but here this particular provider we are not having a provider class here, but we'll see with this version only. So we'll change our EH cache with help of this particular EH cache organization. And here we don't have a IBANET related cache, so we'll try to find out the appropriate the nearest provider class. Op store, MPL internal store. Okay. We'll see okay, so this is all about the our EH cache provider. We'll understand the how this particular EH cache is going to work. And now, so what I want to write here, I want to create a one EH cache configuration file. ehcache.xml. And whenever we are trying to work on the ehcache, so we'll go for the Google find out the ehcache XML sample here. And this is we need to understand here. So where we want to cache, here we are providing it. Okay. And the name here, cache name. So what is the name of the cache we want to provide? And here I want to provide com dot spring dot the package name I want to provide. Okay. So now you can see how many max element we can store here. So these are the size information we can provide here. Getting the point. So first we'll go provided the these are the information. What happened? So let me save here. Okay. The cache is not loading here. What are the information we can store default to? No. Okay. So otherwise, what I want to so max elements in memory, how many max elements we can store? So around 500 elements we can store, right? And how much time the objects we need to available? Ideal we can define like a time to ideal seconds. So you can define the seconds here, and time to live this particular objects. How much time the object we need to live? Okay. So this is the information we can define inside this particular EH cache file. We'll try to run the same example. Observe. So what is the error we are going to get? Okay. Class not found for the time provider. Type provider. We'll go for the implementation classes. EH cache store dot provider. Okay, so maybe we can go for this particular store internally. They're having the provider. Okay.
So this is not the usable. Okay, no such method. So he's expecting constructor. Okay. So what I will do, this particular cache example we can discuss in our tomorrow session. I need to find out the solution regarding this particular cache, and where we define this particular cache, I'm going to comment out here. We'll have a simple example on the cache in our tomorrow session, but now focus on the one-to-one mapping here. So how this particular one-to-one mapping is going to work here? So hb.user and hb.address here, and how many column we are having? 4, and inside this particular user we are having 3, right? So now focus here. Select star from user. We are having ID, we are getting 12, and 1 to 1, and password also 1 to 1. And what about this particular another object here? Select star from hb dot c underscore address here. Now you can see address ID 13, street, city, and zip code here. But here we are not having same ID. If you observe carefully, here we are not having same ID here. The both our ID is having different here. Getting the point? So how this particular both are having different IDs here? Now what we can do here? So to get one ID, what we can do here? Any idea to provide the one ID? What are the information we need to define here? Basically, here we need to define the one more information inside this particular mapping. Both are both does not have a same here. Both are having different here. First, we'll see cascade we made as a all, and after making the cascade here, first what we can do? Inside this particular user, inside this particular class table called address, we need to go for the generator here. Where is our address mapping? Inside this particular address, what we can specify here? Inside this particular generator, inside the generator class here, we provided as a native here. Now what we can do? We can go for the foreign key here. We can go for the foreign key. And after providing this particular foreign key, now, okay, here we are not getting. Param, the param name, what we need to specify here? Property. And what is the name of the property we are having? User. Getting the point? Now here we can make the our, okay, we already make the constant 2 also.
Now what we are understanding is, so the foreign key we are making to the user table here. The foreign key we are making to the user table. So whenever we are making, now if you observe, I'm going to run one more time. So we need to see whether this particular table is inserting. No. So the structure is not updated here. Okay, anyway, we'll try to run the same example 14. And okay. User table we are having 14. And address table we are having 15. So this is we are not going to use. Now what we can do, we'll go for the Hibernate properties. Instead of update, create hyphen drop here. Address to? No. So what happened here? What we are missing? Any wrong we are making here? Basically, user ID and it needs to connect with our same address. So inside this particular user mapping, 1-to-1 name address we are making, and class address, so cascade we provided as a all. Address in the user we provided same only. Native, okay. And the user information, 1-to-1 user, the class we provided as a user, and constraint 2. Okay, we'll remove this. Anything we are missing? Property, street, zip code. Okay, somewhere we need to make inverse here. Foreign key entity name, foreign key is joined. Okay, inverse true. Access entity name, foreign key, lazy formula. Okay, we don't have any information. Okay, here what is an object we need to save here? User address. No. Address ID again we are getting true. Why we are getting true? Type long property name user. Okay, in the address table, what is the property we are having? User. That is correct only. Okay, in the mapping, so first what we are having? So identify generator. ID. Right. Here we are having generator param, but here we don't have. So generator class and param. We'll understand whether we are having param here. The query param. Police for parameter in the filter depth. Okay, generator unique identifier, the class attributes, specify the Java class instance ID, and then the param element. Okay, so basically, the generator information, like what we can specify, they did not provide it here. Okay, but what we provided here, the correct information for and key only. Formula meta, okay. These are not the information. Okay, so otherwise, so I will check with I will take help from the Google what exactly we are missing here. So I need to find out the information. I will get back to you tomorrow. And so tomorrow most probably we'll try to close up the Hibernate concepts here. And only the pending concept we are having, how we can work with the query criteria, and finally the ehcache, one example we are going to discuss, and two association, so one to one and many to one association we are going to discuss. So these are the concepts we are going to discuss in our tomorrow session. Okay, if you are having any questions, so those questions also we can discuss in our tomorrow session here, because today we did not complete any one of the concepts properly. So most probably we'll close up all the concepts here. Okay, we'll continue tomorrow.